Good afternoon. Welcome back. The sugar levels may be high or low, depending on whether you have had an ice cream or sweets or whatever. We'll try to make this very engaging. From morning, perhaps you are listening to the whole Mahabharata Ramayana of telecom and, the challenges and 4G and 5G, and you may be tired. In Mahabharata also, there are different interpretations and commentaries. Oh, Swami Prabhupada ka commentary hai, then you have Shankaracharya's commentary. So our commentary of Facebook, Google, Micromax, and TRAI, we will be little different, I can assure you that, and I'm sure you'll enjoy, and hopefully we'll have time for question and answers, So the session is titled Big Disconnect. I would rather rephrase this as a big opportunity to connect, broadband, connect India in all manners possible, financial, geographical, et cetera. What we're going to do is, we'll talk about the opportunities arising from the broadband. I think it's worthwhile to sort of take a very quick view of the digital ecosystem which is there in the country and on which a lot of opportunities. I think it has been repeated ad nauseam by the Prime Minister that 1 billion-plus Aadhaar cards, 360 million internet, 190 million broadband, and 1 billion-plus mobile connections. All this is connected with 250 million-plus bank accounts. It's 1.3 billion, 6 lakh villages, 2.3 lakh gram panchayats. So this is the geographical and digital sort of broad landscape. Yesterday's World Bank has acknowledged that Aadhaar is creating a new sort of internet, what India has attempted. I think it's very, very appreciative, and it's unparalleled and unheard of anywhere in the world. I think there is a lot likely to happen using Aadhaar and the trinity of GeM. So this is the landscape, and I think perhaps this was covered, but I think worthwhile to look at Digital India. I think it's more than a $1 trillion opportunity because any which way one looks at it, of course there are reports that you have a better penetration of broadband and mobility, it creates a multiplier effect on the GDP, well-known established studies. But you look at it from India point of view, pick up any sector, logistics, transportation, agriculture, water management, fleet management, education, healthcare, there are so many inefficiencies and value loss which can be retrieved through a digital and a better technology platforms. I'm sure that going forward it'll create much bigger opportunity. One of the core pillars of this is broadband as a utility, and then you have governance and services on demand, and that leads to digital empowerment of citizens. The key is broadband as a utility. There are a number of initiatives of the government, Startup India, Make in India, Digital India, e-governance and smart cities, attracting trillions of dollars, billions of dollars of investments. I think this is a very interesting slide I found that what is happening every minute in the ecosystem, and I found it very eye-opening, looking at the number of data points, which clearly shows that the data is going through the roof. Without a robust broadband, a future-proof technology architecture and a future-proof network, we can just collapse. If you look at a little in the longer term, you have 2020. It's slated to have the year 2020, 4 billion connected people, $4 trillion of opportunity, 25 million-plus apps, 25 billion embedded systems, and 50 trillion GBs of data. That also leads to the whole question of converged world, where you have augmented reality, virtual reality, mixed reality, drones, robots, 3D, the host of things perhaps which were discussed, bitcoins and so on and so forth. So this is the landscape, and this is the world in which we live in. When you look at this world, and there are huge, huge opportunities, but there are challenges. The first, it's worthwhile to sort of look into the mirror and ask ourselves, mirror, mirror on the wall, who is the fairest of all. And I think if you look at the Internet Barrier Index, we have a huge problem. We are way down in terms of ease of getting access to the internet. And there are countries smaller than us, much smaller economies. We are a $2.6 trillion economy. They are way ahead in terms of access to internet. So this is one reality which we need to acknowledge and face. The other reality is if you look at the Global Competitiveness Index, out of a rank of 138, where do we stand? I think in all the mobile internet related parameters, we are all way down, above 100. And this is again another reality we must acknowledge, because once we accept reality, then we will look at solutions in a very meaningful manner. And of course, we all know the challenges of banking, healthcare, schools, colleges, and roads, network, et cetera, which are really opportunities. And we continue to be very, very under-fiberized. And if you look at China or other countries, and even in terms of Wi-Fi spots, we have only about 37,000, 38,000, and way below the average, world average. We need much more Wi-Fi spots. And that leads to the other issue, that rural penetration of telecom is a challenge. Yesterday we were discussing something in Northeast, and I think it's a much bigger challenge. There are different reports, but we understand that 50 plus thousand villages today don't have a mobile connectivity. So this is a reality. And I think with this sort of, we will look at the challenge statements and an opportunity statement. And the first is, I would like to kick off the discussion by saying the definition of broadband, which we have sort of adopted as a part of the policy, is it really appropriate? And what is the implication of this definition from a technology policy and investment perspectives? And the government, TRI is also here, they will give them the opportunity to have the last word on everything. So I would start with requesting Gulzar to start giving some comments on this, and then we will see how it moves. Over to you. Working?
Thanks, Hemant. I think this is a great start to the discussion, and thanks for all the commentary. And as you said, this is a different perspective on what's happening in telecom and broadband in the country. And I think this is a great panel to be in. So I really appreciate this. Many friends here among the audience and at the panel. So this is a really interesting time to be here. I would say that this is the most exciting time in telecom that we have seen in the current era. By many, many means. And one of the fundamental three things that are happening right now here, which are almost like breakout things that are happening across telecom and across internet, is we went through a telecom revolution, and that, of course, brought a lot of investment, a lot of growth, economic growth, prosperity to the country. And now we are entering the data revolution. And we are truly entering the data revolution, because all of the current existing technologies of the world, the modern technologies, are merging together and evolving in India and are beginning to take shape. So whether it's 3G, 4G, whether it's Wi-Fi, or whether it's new upcoming devices, what's happening on those devices, whether it's peer-to-peer connectivity, whether it's content distribution technologies, I think there is evidence of all of that and the presence of that in India, and that's the mark of the data revolution. There is a huge awakening happening across the sector in realizing that India's needs are not a billion users with 1 GB per user per month, but India's needs probably are a billion users with 10 GB per user per month. And the question now that the industry faces with, how do you address that? How do you build a network towards addressing that? And I'll quickly talk about two quick pillars that are happening. That's a breakout area, I believe. So one is the telecom revolution to data revolution and that number there. The other is that there is a massive realization that internet, and not just for, you know, the limited audience of the 10, 20 top million users, but across hundreds of millions of users, there is a realization that internet is moving from a luxury to a necessity. And that probably is obvious to you all, but it's not been so obvious across hundreds of millions of users. And that's the shift, that's a bit shift, paradigm shift that's happening. And the third thing is, which is also a breakout realization, and that's the third pillar, is the need and the demand for high speed. There is a huge consciousness rising, and you can go talk to all of the applications that actually give the speed metric. You know, they are rapidly rising, their usage is rapidly rising. I was at Barcelona and the Mobile Congress, and their usage was extremely out there for India. And that need is there, and you know, we are seeing that in our project that we did with railways. You know, there's a project that Google is doing with railways.
So we'll come to that.
And we're seeing that.
Yeah. So right now, you know, I would, you know, I'd say, is this definition, is this 512 kbps appropriate for a nation which is wanting to be a 4 trillion and maybe a 20 trillion economy, you know, in the longer term, and in the shorter term, 5 years, 10 years, you know, $4 trillion economy?
I'll give a very short answer to this. That's not even what we would call narrowband today.
Thank you. So this is your perspective, sir. Yeah,
just to build on what Gulzar said, my personal view on this is it doesn't really matter. It would matter if technology companies started developing products that catered to 512 kbps. It would matter if Jio or Reliance or Vodafone or Airtel would start investing basis this as a benchmark. It would matter if investments came into India, assuming that we need to provide this as a service. Even MTNL does not do that. So does it really matter? It doesn't matter. What gets determined is the speed that consumer wants. And consumer wants a lot more. And just to illustrate that, while that number is not to be proud of, but India breached the 4 Mbps average speed mark in last December. February's TRAI report listed top 4 operators providing download speeds from 8 to 17 Mbps. I think 17 was Reliance, Jio, and uplink speed of 2 to 6. Now it doesn't leave 512 anywhere, so, except for the fact that it makes us a, you know, it's a bit of a joke when you think of this as a benchmark. But my personal view, it doesn't really matter because market determines what it wants.
I think it's very interesting, very, very interesting perspective. And you know, I would like to ask Subhanjit, you know, what is your view? I mean, does this matter, or it's irrelevant, as he says? And then how, you know, how does it impact the devices manufacturing, etc.? You know,
I mean, to the specific question, I totally concur. It doesn't matter because this is driven by use cases. It's not driven, you know, definition does not really matter, right? Because we are seeing how rapidly this whole ecosystem's transforming itself. And I'll just make one point because, you know, you've used the word challenges a lot. I do think that quite often our benchmark, sometimes rightly, is what's happening in outside in the West, et cetera, or indeed how rapidly, let's say, China moved, etc. But we should also accept that in this sector is probably the fastest growing sector that we have seen over the last 20, 30 years in terms of how rapidly it's penetrating. So I think it is a bit of a balanced one. I think the opportunity, it's you know, the half is glass is pretty empty. But we should be proud of also how rapidly we have progressed over the last few years. So I think let's keep it a bit more balanced. And to the point about the definition, I'm not.
It doesn't matter.
Excellent.
So Raj, you know, you are you're the CEO of the Fireflies. And,
Mission
Facebook. Yeah, Mission from Facebook. Sorry, my apologies. You know, identity crisis or management. So what is your view? I mean, do you think this matters? Or it's irrelevant, as many people said, because the market determines.
So I think speed is something that more is always less, and a lot depends upon what you're going to consume on the network. At Facebook and a lot of other app ecosystem, we're trying to make the apps frugal so that they run on low bandwidth network as well. And I think that's a very key aspect of how the consumption and loyalty actually happens. However, if I just take an anecdotal example of Jio, which launched a service which was free. However, within 2 months, we had reports that the customers were upset because the speed was low. So it's always a balancing act. Now, if I look at the proliferation of video more and more in our communication, imagine this in rural part of the country or even in some urban areas. You push a WhatsApp message with video while you're just streaming to download it, and you try to push it out because you've not been able to look at it. So you just create a cascading effect on the network and cause a congestion. So it's speed and the network capacity that we need to build up. Technology exists, but then you have to benchmark is what is the ROI, return on investment. End of the day, it has to make commercial sense for the telecom companies, as well as for the customers, affordability to pay. So I think that's where companies like our startups like Facebook are trying to do a lot more disruption by creating an open ecosystem so that we can drive the lever of cost down, make it open source, make some of the R&D happen right here in India.
So, excellent. And, we'll come to that. We'll have a lot of debate on that.
And also create an app ecosystem which is running on frugal and low speed.
I think this is a very interesting point.
So I think that dimension is important.
Sort of, if you can link that, what you're saying, the frugal dimension of the development with, you know, the definition, what is the official definition, that will be a... So my question would be that because we have an definition of 512 kbps, would that sort of drive an innovative mindset to offer solutions with this sort of the baseline, so, bring forth some very innovative solutions?
So one of the colleagues over here said, I think as long as the products support a higher bandwidth, then it's really an equation of the market dynamics of how much do you need. As I said, more is always less, but there are multiple dimensions of how you scale this. So yes, I think it's an opportunity for India to learn from what we did as we jumped from 2G to 4G. Give more better customer experience when you're building up new networks. Mm-hmm. So it's always good to rehash the definitions, and I always look at what the other parts of the globe are adopting.
Excellent. Sir, as you have the last word on this, Sudhir, Mr. Sigupta, TRI Secretary, your views on this?
No, I agree with all my panelists that speed really doesn't matter. Why? Because presently this 512 kbps is just to sort of separate narrow band and broadband, nothing else. It's just for statistical purpose. Okay. It has nothing to do with our everyday use or usage experience and all. And even if I look at the statistics, even if I change it from 512 to say 2 Mbps, today we have about 350 million broadband total subscribers, out of which about 320 million plus are broadband and others we categorize as narrowband. So these 320 will remain 320 even if we make it 2 Mbps, because these 320 are the wireless broadband, and the technology which is being used today is capable of 2 Mbps. So it doesn't matter whether we change it from 512 to 2 Mbps. It will remain the same thing. And though you are showing a number of developed countries with 20 Mbps plus and all, but if you see the definition, this is what may be available in those countries, but if you see the definition, whether it is ITU definition or in these developed countries, still it is 512 or 1 Mbps or 2 Mbps, not more than that. France is 512. So probably what this definition of what is broadband, anything above X speed is broadband, that you can say, but it really doesn't matter in today's world. Because my friend was saying that after coming in of certain operators, the data speed has gone up, 16, 17 Mbps. In fact, I'll give you the statistics recently of December 2016. The data consumption per subscriber is today 3.3 GB per month.
On an average.
On an average, all India. which used to be about 600 to 700 MB about four months back.
Four times.
So
it doesn't matter.
The
reason why I sort of brought this is because, you know, I've seen in some forums and other places. Oops, sorry. It's not working.
Hello, can you hear me? Yeah. So, you know, the reason I've asked this question to the panel is because I've heard in many panels and, some intellectual discussions that, you know, because we have a very low definition, our aspirations are low, and therefore the policy is driven and investments, etc. So I think it is clearly the view that it doesn't matter. And as you said, it's just statistical. Neither the policy nor...
If I may add, you haven't given the full definition of what is broadband as per the...
ITU.
ITU or our DOT. Any technology, wireless, when you come to wireless, because wireless you can't say you'll always get 512. You can even drop down to zero. Or you can go up to 10 or 15 Mbps. So it is that if the technology is capable of providing a two-way connectivity above a certain speed, it's a capability.
Correct.
So today, whatever networks are there, they're all capable.
Yeah. So that's very, very interesting. And I think that leads to the other second part. You know, what are the different sort of technologies, we should look at from an India perspective, from a suitability in terms of terrain, the geographical spread and the affordability and sustainability in the Indian context. And this time I will not make a mistake, hopefully. And I would start with you, Raj, to give a perspective on, you're driving a big change in Wi-Fi and so on and so forth. So from a technology perspective, if you can throw some light, which is suitable, Could Wi-Fi be the last mile connectivity paradigm,
Thanks, Hemant. Just to answer your question on can Wi-Fi be the last mile connectivity solution, can it be one of the solutions? Yes. Can it be the main solution? Probably not. Can it be a critical solution? Certainly, yes. I'll elaborate on this a little bit more. While I work exclusively on Wi-Fi, but there's no doubt in our mind that going forward, you will have a 4G-centric broadband penetration, which will be complemented by a number of technologies that will be integrated from the user experience perspective. That could mean fiber at home. That could mean Wi-Fi at public hotspots, busy streets, so on and so forth. That could also mean drones and balloons, which a lot of new age companies are coming up with. Depending on commercial viability and terrain difficulty, which justifies commercial viability also. But a lot of these would be fillers. Another, not exactly technology, but again, an innovative use of a medium. People talk about using cable TV operators as providers of Wi-Fi, providers of home broadband and SME broadband. That again, I think is a great idea in India because there are large parts of urban and semi-urban areas which have cable, but don't have great reach for broadband. But that again can't solve the problem because we don't really have a national level aggregated cable player. There are too many fragmented players. All of them coming together under one platform is logistically improbable, if not impossible.
So what I hear you say is that there is not one technology or one approach. It'll all depend on the whole mix of technologies.
That's right.
And suitability.
My view is, given that India is going to be a mobile country for many, many years, we see forward, your 4G LTE will be the prime driver of reach coverage, capacity, coverage and reach primarily. And you will have Wi-Fi and
FTH,
TV, white space, drones, balloons, everything coming in depending on which one succeeds the most. They'll fill in as fillers. Say, for example, in Northeast, you could have a replication of what Latin America does with Google, which is balloons. It's horses for courses. But as a core, as a nucleus of the solution set, it will be 4G and going forward 5G.
And Wi-Fi, it does not take away the importance of my job. Wi-Fi is going to be very, very critical. But probably the single largest supplementary technology that seamlessly integrates with standard mobile technologies rather than a standalone technology that can support all our dreams and aspirations for digital India.
Right. Thank you. Yeah. So, Gulzar, I think this whole question of which technology, you have been doing some wonderful work. Who would have thought railways stations will start providing free Wi-Fi? And I think if you can give a perspective on what made Google look at this and what are the learnings, and from a technology perspective, do you see this sort of becoming the last mile or a very good alternative to the fiber and so on and so forth?
I think this is really an interesting question, especially in India, which is such a dynamic landscape, such a varied landscape. The opportunities and challenges are segmented, are different, and as you go across the different regions of the country. But there's a unifying factor to any development of infrastructure out there. And to add to what Raj said, there are some fundamental investments that have to be made. And I believe actually the core of that investment is not so much, it is in wireless as a manifestation. But to start with, that investment is in the fiberization of the country. And
so we can't run away from that.
The reality of the economic and physics reality of things is today, as it stands, is that as your capacity requirements go up, your backhaul cost should go down. And that economics essentially works with fiber today. Unless and until tomorrow the physics is challenged and wireless happens to create increasingly more GBs in the backhaul without step function of investment. I think that's, unless that changes, the reality is that you need fiber. And any such country out there, developed country or emerging countries, they've all had to have a basic fiber investment. And the problem with that has been, whether it's the US, whether it's Europe, or whether it's India, the problem has been who does that? Right? How do you make that? I think now the world is starting to realize is that has to be like an investment of roads. That is a basic necessity infrastructure that the government not only has to facilitate, but also has to help build it out. Not only in rural areas, but also in urbanization. By way of policy, yes, for surely. By way of enablement, facilitation, but also by way of investment. And that's the base layer. On top of that layer, yes, cellular, as Raj mentioned, cellular connectivity-wise, 4G is the technology, and that has to be omnipresent. Wi-Fi, the interesting thing that is happening in Wi-Fi, as I started to say in my first chat, was that as the data revolution is taking place, one thing is becoming clear, and by clear by, the project that we are doing, that LTE and public Wi-Fi need to coexist. And the coexistence of this is actually together going to fulfill the requirements that we have as a user, the requirements as we have as an industry. And we haven't achieved that today, but it's beginning. And we are realizing that by the railways project that we did. Today, there are about 110 stations that we completed in the last 1 year, and 114 stations along with RailTel as the partner, who's the telecommunications arm of Indian Railways. It's a very interesting learning there that while in the environment today, as you see, there is a promotional LTE offer going on out there by Jio.
Right.
By way of which data and voice is free. There are obviously competitive freebies being offered by other large operators as well. And in that environment, you have 6 million users connecting to Wi-Fi at the railway stations.
6 million?
6 million users on a monthly basis. So 60 lakh users. That's incredible. When I started this project, when I conceived this project 3 years back, I was challenged both internally and externally to think about this and say, this is insane. At the railway stations, people are struggling with all sorts of basic amenities. You have trains, things that are not always organized. People are worried about their families, their luggage, their security, their water. Who would have time to connect to Wi-Fi? And even if they did, how long will they remain on it and what will they use? My own analysis said that people will use 20 MB per session of data. That's what our own analyst had predicted. And you know that the usage today is on an average 400 MB per user per session.
So 200 times.
And that's really, it's unbelievable, right? And what that tells us is, and of course, you know, we are discussing with operators, and we are learning that this is incremental usage. So obviously, there is a huge latent demand that is beginning to get served. And this is only has been possible, frankly, because RailTel had the vision, and Railways had that vision, to lay fiber, 45,000 kilometers of shared access neutral fiber, connecting about 4,000 cities and towns by way of the railway lines. This Wi-Fi network has been possible only because of that fiber network. So the fundamental is that. On top of that, you could build, you know, LTE networks, you could build small cells, you could build Wi-Fi, but that investment has to happen in cities, that investment has to happen in rural areas. And I think that focus, though that realization is there, but I haven't seen as much enablement or as much focus of that. And I really sympathize with the overall telecom ecosystem. They have made so many investments over a period of time, and it is really important to make sure that that sector remains healthy. All the large telecom operators who've invested in this space, their time, energy, investment over the last two decades, they need to remain healthy, and for them to remain healthy also, this fundamental investment is essential. Because if they have to penetrate LTE to the last nooks and corners of this country, if they have to get to a point where high frequency is used in small cells in a room like this, there has to be fiberization all around. So that's really important.
That's an interesting perspective. But can you share, you know, with us, what are the Google experience around the world? You know, in Northeast, I think was mentioned, whether, you know, some of the learnings which you have had in other countries, you know, the balloon or whatever, other technologies, are they relevant? Are they sustainable in a long-term solution, or they are one-off solutions? What is your viewpoint? You know?
So I think we have to understand the journey of economic sustainability starts from, you know, scaling usage. It cannot start like, you know, for example, there have been many attempts to make Wi-Fi sustainable by, you know, just starting to charge on Wi-Fi, on public Wi-Fi. And the problem with that approach or any such approach is that you have to start the journey with scaling, getting enough usage and users on a new technology, on a new means, on a new approach, and then monetizing it. So the journey of monetization does not start by opening revenue channels. The journey of monetization starts from getting to a point where scale is achieved, where users are achieved. And different, and I think some of the investments in technology have to be made with the understanding that this, you are making progress on the scientific front. You are making progress on, you know, what's possible. And then, you know, work backwards from making it economically viable. Because if you start to think about that now, I don't think so it would be possible to make investments in, for example, in space-based tech.
This is a very interesting perspective, that start with technology and then look at viability. This is a very, very interesting perspective. And, I'll turn to our colleague from Facebook. And I think it will be very interesting to hear, you know, the initiatives you are taking with the drones and whatnot. And, you know, what is your view, Free Basics?
Sure. I love Free Basics. So our approach at Facebook has been more, again, we pride ourselves as a startup in the tech area. And as much as I want to believe that 4G, 5G is going to solve all the connectivity problems in this country, skepticism sets in. There is limitation of spectrum, there are financial considerations that come in. So you will need to have a complementary technology that actually solves for the last mile connectivity. So if I break it down further, yes, fiber is important. You can't live without fiber, but is fiber the only solution? So what we are trying to do is solve technology at a few layers. One, we're trying to right now test a few solutions which use the E-band, V-band to provide gigabit Ethernet into your homes or backhaul, whatever is needed.
Even backhaul.
We are today using unlicensed microwave to actually take the fiber from the central POPs in major cities and take them out to the rural communities. So that's happening. And it's not only one network of a few hundred access points. We're talking about four different networks, four different states of the country with four different ISPs and telcos. For us, the journey started about a year and a half back, where we said, Wi-Fi as a technology exists. how can we improve that as a tech? But at the same time, we don't believe in doing small pilots. We like to do something that scales. And that's where we started with the business model. So our approach was a bit different, but I think both Google's approach, Facebook's approach is, I'll say, complementary in a sense. They're trying to achieve a common mission, but the paths are different. Our learnings are in the 3 to 4 networks we have today, average 40 terabytes of data is used every month. And it's a paid model. And in the paid model, we do not wire up your home. We expect people to come out in public hotspots, consume, go back. And what is enabling that is a bunch of retailer ecosystem. So what we thought, and I think we firmly believe this, and as a company, that we have to create social value over here. And the ecosystem, the ISP needs to make money, the entrepreneur who's selling the service needs to make money, and the tech has to be so low cost and so less intensive on power consumptions and rentals that the cost base becomes manageable and the model is monetizable. I think the 4 networks we have are giving us early results that yes, we are on the right track, and I think very soon we should be making this commercial. And these are not only with small ISPs. I have like 2 telco operators who are actually doing this with us in various parts of the country. And the pattern is a straight line, all of them showing the same patterns. Usage, propensity to pay, but yeah, they need speed and quality and affordability. So that's working well for us. On the other areas, we continue to improve how Wi-Fi as a technology is what we know. So if you look at it, what comes in the way of scaling Wi-Fi networks is the cost of data centers that you need to build up to manage a lot of those web interfaces. So that's where the scale of Facebook comes in. A lot of stuff that's allowed from a regulatory perspective, we take it into the Facebook data centers that are global. So why build up something that already exists? And the part of the regulatory framework that we need to host in India, and I'd love to actually see it become more and more open, as is in APAC and Africa, we serve it over here. But that removes a chunk of cost from the ISP. Similarly, on the access point, we're trying to take the control plane away from the gateway. We're trying to push it in the access point. There's enough processing over there. So how do we make it frugal so that tomorrow an entrepreneur says, hey, I want to be an Express Wi-Fi reseller, goes by a certified access points, plugs into a backhaul, and lo and behold, you're an ISP. And good part is TRA has been very supportive in some of the discussions that we've been having, very, very supportive of the new thoughts. I am pretty optimistic of the monetization and scalability of Wi-Fi.
Wonderful. And just to come back, can you share something on the drones?
I know. So that is always the nice part. So there were 2 approaches. One was what we tried to solve for Africa, where we have a lack of backhaul infrastructure, i.e. fiber. There's no fiber over there. So we were, first of all, investing in fiber, both in India and Africa and Indonesia right now, to build capability. That's one. Second, we were wanting to get our own satellite up, which could be used purely as a backhaul commodity. Purely for backhaul. And I think if we go deeper, satellite as a access technology has a cost dynamics, which is still, I think, not mass scale. And you will need some kind of a last mile access, be it on E-band or be it on Wi-Fi. Multiple options exist. And then, of course, we have Aquila, our famous drone, where there are a bunch of nice high-tech stuff that's going in. We're experimenting with free space optics, which can push about 1 gigabit per second out in the stratosphere and beams down. That is going through the trials. More than the tech, it has to qualify for the flying safety, FAA. And it's a period of time which has to log no accidents, no issues, before we can commercialize it. But yeah, early days, but going well. A bunch of smart people are actually working on and making that viable. But potentially, it will first go to Africa and then come to India, where we first test. The Indian regulatory environment requires us to be more compliant, so we'll have to solve for that and then bring it to India.
The question I think which sort of comes in minds of many people, and especially in my mind, is that this satellite drone, is it a longer term solution, or is it an intermediary solution, or is it a solution where you don't have other infrastructure? So can it exist along with the, in a country like India, you will have fiber, Wi-Fi, 4G, LTE, maybe 5G, and satellite? Or it will be those places where you don't have anything and therefore satellite?
So I think it will be selective, to be very honest with you. So, and I love the example of Northeast you took over, and I'm going to build upon that. So my newest network is going to go live in Shillong in a few weeks' time. Where, contrary to what I believed, I saw multiple fiber providers with enough capacity available over there.
In Shillong?
In Shillong. Okay, and there are three or four of them which we could choose from. And that was one of the areas we were talking about, satellite or drone connectivity, which would get backhaul in. But yes, there are certain remote parts where you will have no ways of getting the backhaul in. That's the areas that qualify for the drones or the satellites.
Thank you. Subhajit, we are talking of something which India needs and something which perhaps Bharat needs. And there is still a difference between India and Bharat. So what is your point of view on the whole technology, and more particularly from a devices and other point of view, which you're spearheading?
So we are part of that ecosystem, which is frankly further downstream. So we are kind of takers of where the technology moves as opposed to drive the technology. So I'd probably focus a little bit of here and now. So our view, of course, is clearly 4G will become the backbone in our head. Just to throw you some numbers, as an organization, we were quite surprised by how rapidly consumers took up 4G. Just to throw some numbers, I think it took about 3 years for 3G devices to capture 2/3 of the market. It's taken about 8 months for 4G devices to capture about 75% of the market. So that just goes to show that even from a consumer perspective, they're kind of ready to be future-proof, even if they're not on a 4G network plan right now. But they want their devices, they want to be ready for that. And so to some extent, we're keeping an eye out on what's happening, especially the Google Station thing is, every time we see the data and we say, whoa, this is going faster and deeper than what we had anticipated. So there's a lot of interest. But for us, it is how do we solve actually for the access issue from a device perspective? Because let's be honest, 2016 was supposed to be the year where smartphones would overtake feature phones. That did not happen.
Yeah.
We still, to a large extent, we are planning for the future, but we should keep in mind the huge number of folks who are still not really connected. So I think there are issues here and now which organizations like us in the ecosystem are trying to solve for, while there are other folks in the ecosystem who are getting probably ready for the next 2 or 3 years. I think the one thing that we can all be sure about is the technology looks far away, but it'll come to us faster than we had anticipated. I think that's the only surety.
That's interesting. So what you're saying is that there is a India and there is a Bharat. And I think, should we bifurcate the India and Bharat from a technology and perspectives? And, and I would request Mr. Sudhir Gupta, to have the last word on this whole technology and the difference between India and Bharat. And do we need to really make a distinction? Or we are doing injustice by making a distinction?
Coming to the first question, the technology part. I don't think there will be any one technology or any one media which is really suitable for pan-India. So, two of my friends talk a lot about Wi-Fi. Wi-Fi and fiber are actually complementary. Wi-Fi is the last mile. Or last mile access, and fiber is a backhaul. So you can't have Wi-Fi without fiber, probably. Or either it has to be fiber or maybe microwave, which is not that efficient as far as the data is concerned. One technology which missed our panelists on which we in TRAI are very gung-ho is the cable TV network. Today we have about 100 million plus households which are cable TV enabled, let's say, and which translate to, if you take about 4.2, 4.3 average per household, so it translate to about 420 million consumers or people in the country. And if even 25 to 30% of that is can be used for providing broadband by slight upgradation by using DOCSIS 2.0, and the technologies are available, then there will be sudden jump in the number of broadband people who have access to broadband at their homes. We have been trying since last couple of years for there are certain minor issues which needs to be sorted out by the government, but it's still under progress. The second thing on which we have, in fact, very recently we have come out with our paper also on Wi-Fi. So we feel that, like you gave the statistics, as on 2016, the last when we checked up, we had about 35,000 to 36,000 Wi-Fi hotspots in the country, compared with about 10.3 million in France and around 10 million in USA and about 6 million in UK. So we are nowhere. And that's why we are on the 138 or one whatever number we are. But so we have tried to think out of box in our recent paper. I would suggest our audience that if they can get hold of the paper, it's on our website, www.tra.gov.in. Try to go through that paper. What we have tried to see is, like, number of years back, somewhere in 90s, there was that STDP issue, which revolutionized the availability of telecom in the country. In villages where you don't have the road, you don't have water, but you used to have a STDP issue, and one or two homes used to subside because of that issue. So we have come out with a similar kind of a concept in our paper, where we have called it PDO, Public Data Office. So what we are saying is that small entrepreneurs or even small grocery shop or parchun ki dukan wala or photocopier or coffee shop and those kind of people, they can become PDOs. Mm-hmm. And they don't have to do anything, just provide electricity for a small box, sort of Wi-Fi, for the Wi-Fi hotspot. And there'll be another category of people which our friends can be, which we have called public data office aggregators. Okay. Who will manage the authentication, who will manage the payment system and all those things. And that guy does not have to do anything, the small guy. And that can give a very big fillip to the availability of broadband in the country, because with Digital India coming in, if we don't have connectivity, what do I do? How do I make the payment? Correct. Or how do I the grocery shop collect the payment? Or do some other things? The government is doing so much things on for the digital transactions, but non-availability of broadband or internet will probably doing all the whole hard work. So we are also, then third technology which we feel can also provide a fillip to the broadband penetration is satellite. Because today, as high throughput satellites are available, which can give throughput in gigabits, as my friend is saying, but again, there is some problems. The our space policy needs some tweaking, and till that happens, people cannot provide satellites with the Ka band, which is today it's not permitted in our country. So those are the tweakings in the policy which we feel should happen very so soon, so that we can have this kind of the broadband penetration. So what I'm saying is all the technologies will be there, and as you're saying, should we have difference between the urban and the rural? I doubt, because especially for broadband, because our urban is also in no good shape as far as broadband is concerned.
That's a very interesting perspective you're bringing.
Listen, today we have only about 20 million wired broadband connections in the country. We have about 400 million or 500 million urban people, and only 20 million wired broadband. So I doubt if we can make that kind of a distinction.
Interesting. Thank you. Thank you. It's very, very interesting. So that, I think the common theme is that we need various technologies. There is not one solution. But the other equally important thing is fiber is, you know, the backbone, without which it will be all kite flying or balloon flying or drone or whatever. So this is interesting. And I think that leads to the question, you know, we talked about the technology. We talked about whether the definition was relevant. But I think the other important point is that somewhere, you know, I think you hinted and somebody also picked up the whole question of what comes first, the viability or the technology, you know? And one view was that if you get too much focused on viability and economics, then, you know, you'll get away from development of the technology. And the other view is, you have to have viability and sustainability before you look at technology and, you know, offering. So I would, I would start with you, Gulzar. From your point of view and from a Google point of view, what comes first? And I think you hinted, but if you can sort of develop and give some thinking, especially with railways, you're doing it free. Somebody has to pay, you know. Who's going to pay?
That's definitely always an interesting question for any technology domain. How do you prioritize, or how do you place one before the other? But before we go there, I just wanted to build upon, quickly on the last conversation where respected secretary, mentioned about the policy headwinds that we are getting. I think that's a very relevant point, because policy in the environment that we are in, if all these technologies have to come in, if we do believe that these are all relevant, whether it's space-based technologies, whether it's Wi-Fi, whether it's fiber, or whether it's last-mile wireless, as Munish mentioned, I think, and all of them have their roles to play, but policy is really an enabling factor in that. And I would really like to congratulate TRAI on the headwinds that they're giving to some of the progressive work on Wi-Fi, because that's really going to open up what you call the marketplace. And in any healthy economy, if you look at whether it's telecom or whether it's something else, a marketplace or an aggregator place is really an essential thing. You look at e-commerce, you look at health sector, you look at manufacturing, you look at services sector, you need aggregation, you need marketplaces to bring people together for better and more transactions and for different kinds of transactions to happen.
The experience.
Yes, the experience, and also for multiple players to come and contribute to that. So because marketplace brings, sort of democratizes the sector and brings together the smaller players, the mid-segment players, and the large players together to buy into that. And investors to also look at that as that domain, as one domain, and then make investments in it. Because otherwise, investors would be very fragmented, and it would be very one-off kind of investments or very large player kind of investments that would happen in the sector, which I think telecom really needs it. Whether it's small cells, whether it's Wi-Fi, I think telecom sector needs that, and it would benefit both the operators, the internet players, the industry in general, and of course the users. I think that's a very relevant progress that we are seeing in this sector. Coming to your question on viability and technology, viability is undoubtedly, the economics and viability is an important factor. But depends on where you are looking at. Are you looking at new technologies? Because when you look at new technologies, the cost definitions have not come in. And without the proper costing in place, it's very difficult to determine what's viable today. For technologies that exist today, for example, fiber and Wi-Fi, yes, viability is an important question. But when we started in public Wi-Fi, what we figured out a few years back is, fundamentally, it's not a new technology. People have tried doing public Wi-Fi for the last 10, 12 years, and it hasn't worked out because the scale has not been there, because the space has been very fragmented. How do you enable ISPs? And that's what motivated us to create Google Station. Google Station is sort of a technology platform which enables the ISPs and establishments to easily create that Wi-Fi experience. And by that way, become viable. And by way of doing that, their authentication requirements, their data storage requirements, their security requirements, their management, network management requirements are all taken care of, and then they can focus on creating different revenue streams, and those revenue streams have to be multiple. They cannot just be one business model out there. While you address the access point costs and you address the viability of the overall thing, you have to enable the venues and the establishments and the government to create either offload or paid Wi-Fi or advertisement or different kind of revenue channels to support a network which is different from cellular. Cellular, yes, cellular has a very set business model and that works. And that's also today, in some ways, very challenged. But for Wi-Fi in particular, the question around viability will be addressed by, one, the marketplace, which, you know, different platforms will enable and which is what we are investing in. And the other, it will be addressed by enabling different revenue streams.
So what I hear you say, and if I can rephrase, what you're saying is the consumers need not pay directly. The service providers to the consumers will pay if you create a marketplace.
I think the different revenue channels will enable
the support
in depending on where you are creating this network, because whether you're in a transit environment or whether you're in a rural environment or whether you are in an airport or whether you're in a mall, I think that determines what will play out for networks which are more sort of localized.
Okay.
Right? And so revenue models will differ from that.
Okay. So, Subhajit, you are providing some amazing solutions for the devices. So there are two parts of the affordability: one is the service and the devices. And what is your perspective? You know, what comes first? I mean, how do you deal with the challenge of affordability?
So I think as Micromax, and I think many players in this industry, we're very, very clear that keeping on pushing down the access cost, especially to semi-urban and rural consumers, is the fundamental critical challenge for the entire industry. And you know, we work with a larger ecosystem, you know, our partners, whether they're in China or with Google, you know, with on the Android system. And while we've done quite a few of these things in the past, we're actually very proud, because with Google's partnership, in fact, got one of these samples here, we're on the verge of launching a smartphone approved by Google, which is going to be priced below 3,000 rupees.
So below $50, that
way below $50, 3,000 rupees. I think when we were talking to the folks in Google, this is called the Bharat series. I think this is going to be the first smartphone in the world at this price point. And so this is just one of the examples. You know, we are also doing the same on the feature phones. The question is, how do we take away one of the barriers? Now, obviously, the data costs and lots of other issues will continue to remain. And to Gulzar's point, there's also an ecosystem issue. Just remember, access to content in regional language is still an issue. But for instance, you know, we are focusing on those use cases which are coming up. So whether it's payments, that's becoming a strong use case. And we think that bringing down the device cost, bringing down the cost of the entire network and for the consumers, that's the way to really drive penetration right now. And yeah, we're pretty proud to be part of this ecosystem right now.
If I can sort of ask you, at this point, you will make money?
Yes, we will make money. I don't think we will ever launch a product we don't make money on.
That's a very, very interesting, question. And if I can ask the Facebook gentleman, what is your viewpoint, you know, on this whole debate about what comes first, affordability or the, you know, you just invest in technology and then figure out who will pay for it, or vice versa?
So it's a bit of a contrarian view, and I'll start with an example, right? Wi-Fi as a technology has existed for about 5 to 10 years now, and there's a bunch load of money that's sitting in USO fund that's unutilized. For some reason, the money is there, the tech is there, but it's not happened. What we are doing is enabling the tech wrapped around a business model. Now, by no means I'm saying that the business model needs to be proven before the tech comes into the market. What we are trying to do, as I talked about, we not only try the tech, but also the underlying business model. or we have a choice to run as a CSR project, which we at Facebook believe doesn't scale. And I think you've seen enough free Wi-Fi networks die their death over a period of time. Second key aspect is we see our role as catalyst to the industry. We're not going to be an operator. Can we catalyze and build local capability within the country? Can we create that business model, the technical ecosystem, so that we sprout successful ISPs and open source it? That's what we did with data centers a few years back. We perfected the technology and then open sourced it. Wi-Fi is going the same way. It's not going to be different. But it's my personal belief and the belief of a lot of us who actually are pushing this tech across Africa, India, and APAC. We think business model is a key for a ISP to start thinking of scaling. If the ISP thinks the money or the dole is going to come from one of the companies, there's no skin in the game. There's no skin in the game. And yes, free has a perception. We believe the masses, whether rural or urban, needs to get quality at an affordable price. And that's been the punchline for Express Wi-Fi: high speed, quality, low, affordable networks. And I think that's working for us.
Yeah, you have a supporter in the new FCC chairman, you know. That's interesting. And, you know, from your perspective, how do you see, Raj, you know, this affordability? You know, when you start building the Wi-Fi, you know, the focus area is creating 10 million or whatever Wi-Fi. We have only 35,000, 36,000 Wi-Fi hotspots. How who's going to pay for it? Somebody has to pay for it. What is your view?
Thanks, Hemant. Hemant, that's a question that we've all struggled to answer, but hopefully we are getting closer and closer by the day. Affordability here, it's about operators' affordability to serve the customers by installing large number of Wi-Fi hotspots. Then automatically consumers' affordability comes in. See, Wi-Fi as a technology actually is rather unique compared to any other licensed technology, so to speak, because it allows you to put the same access point, same access network to multiple use. I mean, I think of it as a Swiss knife. Swiss knife may have one common hinge, but it can have a contraption coming out that can open your wine bottle. It can also have a nail filer for your, for your grooming. Which essentially means that if you're able to put together a model in which you're able to create large enough infrastructure, scaled enough infrastructure that is able to serve multiple purposes which Wi-Fi can only serve, then you have a winner of a model. To give you an example, if this hotel needs Wi-Fi for its room residents, which is against a password that they get when they check in, because they have the authentication data with them, passport copy or Aadhaar card or whatever. Then this convention needs Wi-Fi for a temporary purpose. Somebody would pay for this, saying that I want Wi-Fi access to all my customers so that they can tweet their presence here. Then you have the staff here needing Wi-Fi to be able to access their laptops and iPads to serve the customers. Now, each of them need not be on different infrastructure. If all of them are on the same infrastructure, which technology allows you to do that, you have created a model whereby everybody pays a little bit and yet it is affordable for everyone. On top of that, now if you ride the need for Wi-Fi for telecom operators to offload, then you have two more players or three more players or four more players going forward in any location who are willing to share that burden of cost, yet not get burdened by the entire cost that it becomes completely unviable. So to answer your question, affordability is something which needs to be worked towards and made possible instead of being taken as something which is given or not given.
Okay.
So again, just to reemphasize, it's not so much about technology because it exists. It's not so much about investing in technology which is moonshot. It's about investing time and energy in creating models and doing the dirty work of putting things together that allows you to make it viable for everyone, not just one.
Yeah, and we'll ask Mr. Sudhir Gupta Saab to give your perspective and who's going to pay and how we're going to pay for proliferation of broadband, you know.
Listen, I'm not a businessman, so it's difficult for me to. You ask the wrong question from Facebook. They will always, they have so much money, they will start this thing without thinking about the viability. But just enlightened note. Thing is, viability has nothing to do with technology. As far as the consumer is concerned, for consumer, how do you give me the service? It's immaterial for me. It should be viable or affordable to me. And that affordability has no definition. If I like the thing, then probably I'll be willing to pay X amount. If I don't like it, I won't do it even if you give me free or free plus kind of thing. So it is basically linked with what is the content I'm getting. Today, like he mentioned about availability of content in vernacular language. Now, today it's not available. Unfortunately, we have hardly 11 to 12% of the population who are considered to be knowing English. So 88% of the population, for that, where's the content? If you see the example of some of our Asian neighbors, Asian countries, where the broadband has penetrated to a very large extent, and like Korea, if you take, or China, Japan, they develop the content in their vernacular language. We are still in the process of doing it. We are more on, okay, once there be supply, demand will come up. But probably that's wrong as far as the broadband is concerned. You have to create the content which is for the for our public. Here, probably you are India and Bharat, maybe more apt to say. So what I think is that as we are trying to provide the supply side, we should pay equal attention to the demand. Try to, and let me say that all this e-governance, though they are very good things for the day-to-day life of the person, but no one is going to buy broadband for his home for doing
e-governance
or this kind of thing. He needs entertainment, he needs those music, he needs those kind of things. So unless those are things which are available to him, the viability will remain illusionary.
Thank you. So I think I'm sure the audience has a lot of questions, and we'll open the floor to questions. But till the time sort of they warm up, you know, I would ask each of you to give quickly a point of view on what is one thing from a regulation policy perspective that needs to be done. So feel free to, you know, raise your hand, ask questions. We will stop here. Okay, yeah, there is a gentleman in a turban there behind. So I think one of the questions could be that all this technology is there and we have all this, there is enough money with the Googles and the Facebooks and so on and so forth, but why are we where we are? So yes, sir, please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, this is Dilpreet. I'm from telecom engineering at Uber. My question is, most of the companies right now are moving towards a mobile-only product, like for example, Uber as well. And the biggest challenge we face is connectivity. And the question is, how is Google working with projects like Google Fi? And how is Facebook innovating on that? And how would Micromax enable technologies like Google Fi coming into India and helping this?
So we'll start with the, okay, Google.
I think we'll have to call the Google search engine now that you have called for it. I think you're very right. The question on connectivity being a basic requirement when there are so many startups and companies investing in payment solutions, mobile banking solutions. I think connectivity is being addressed from both perspectives. One is what's happening on the devices and what's happening on the client application side. So there are multiple solutions being drawn so that there is optimization of data on the device. There is usage of data in such a way that some of the offline transactions are enabled. So that there's definitely an investment across search, maps, YouTube, you know, YouTube offline, maps offline, all of that investment is being made. And then, as you can see, the partnership that we have in the country with Railways Wi-Fi, our hope is that more ISPs and more venues will adopt that. And today, you know, the amount of data that is being transacted on it and the amount of people connecting on it every day, some of the use cases that we are seeing are payments, actually. which is very interesting, that people at the station are making digital payments after having connected to Wi-Fi. Our hope is that as more ISPs sort of adopt it and you know, Google Station kind of helps them enable such experiences elsewhere, you know, those connectivity solutions will happen.
So I think there are questions for a number of people, so I'll hand over to...
Yes, so at Facebook, so we try to solve it at two layers. One is, of course, trying to make the apps frugal so that you can work in a lower bandwidth environment. I think that's very important for us to solve. Even in urban areas, we are dependent, highly dependent on cellular networks to come. Surprisingly, when we went to rural India to kind of see how we want to connect them, I was not expecting to see high-end phones. And I was surprised to see Samsung and at times iPhones and iPads out in the market. So at times, we in the urban community sitting in Delhi have a very, very different view of what rural India is about. The stuff that Micromax is doing is definitely going to be very interesting. It's going to get the devices much more into the hands of users. But the fact is, rural India at times has more disposable income than urban India. And they're investing in lifestyle. So I don't see that as an inhibitor for right now in any of the networks we have. Apart from that, connectivity, as I actually have said many times over here, once I have a business model and the ISPs see they can make money, it's up to them how they want to push out to various geographies. We are not prescriptive about it. Our vision is to enable them rather than actually be prescriptive about it.
So, you know, a lot of our Micromax's business is actually just at the entry level and helping folks move into the digital world. The way we tend to do this, of course, is to work really, really closely with, you know, pretty much all the big players in the ecosystem. I'll give you a classic example, actually with Google. So one of the use cases that we figured out, which helped a guy move from feature phones into smartphones, was actually video calling. It was as simple as that, which is, you know, just the ability to see somebody else's face. And so we partnered with Google on Google Duo, their voice calling, video calling app. And I think the more we can work closely with folks in the ecosystem, you know, whether it's Facebook's messenger payment bots and, you know, the whole AI stuff that you folks are doing, or how do we take some of our stuff that we are doing on digital, but also having an offline play so that it kind of connects back into the real world and you'll see that. So we tend to work with lots of guys at the early stage of concept development for our phones. I will just leave one more last thought out here, which is especially with the whole transaction things happening, with a lot of public access to internet, one of the things that we guys in Micromax are certainly focusing on and working on is actually security. Because I think that's going to become a significant consumer-based conversation as we go forward. And I think, again, that needs an ecosystem solution. It's not anything that any one of us can play a part. But these are emerging trends that will come up just because the whole technology and you know, the level of technologies keeps on going up every literally quarter.
Yeah. So I think this is very interesting, and that is why perhaps a SoftBank made investment in a big chip company. Yeah, any other question? Yes. how much time do we have so that, you know, we leave the audience before the audience leaves us, you know?
Hello? Okay.
Yeah.
Hi, this is for Manish. I have...
Yeah, go ahead.
Manish, this is regarding free basics. I'm Vishwadi from Idea Cellular. So, one thing, has Jio stolen the limelight of free basics? Second point, with the success of free data offer, does it establish the potential that free basics could have had in India, if not stuck in the net neutrality rule? And third point, now that Jio is itself moving to monetization, so do you think free basics stuck in net neutrality and free data having gone back to prime offer, now the surge that we were seeing in mobile broadband, the exponential surge that was coming, it will go back to linear, and again we might need some other booster, maybe from other segments or from some other player, in order to take the continuity forward?
So So I hope, I think you're asking the question to the regulator.
Actually, it can be both because it is stuck with the regulators.
No, I think we should ask the regulator how they're going to resolve this. Over to you, sir.
Sorry, this is a issue on which I wouldn't like to talk publicly.
So, since you alluded to free basics, as much as this talk is about broadband connectivity in India, free basics is running in 60 countries with about 80 operators, and we have about close to 45 million subscribers who are using it. Now, we had a feedback in India, and that's been pulled back. And I think we can debate right or wrong, but that's the end of it. What did we try to achieve with the free basics? It was, if you are a first-time internet user, you can get kind of overwhelmed with the number of sites. And as one of the chief ministers said, one of the first use cases is porn, unfortunately, for the young students. We didn't want that to happen. But again, probably the approach could have been customized for India. That being said, I believe the free data offer, I would not like to comment on what's going to happen to Jio. I don't think I run the business. It's not appropriate for me. But Facebook has been growing organically in our what we call MAP, monthly active people, with or without Jio. Yes, Jio gave us a bump, but I'm sure other operators are behind.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Please go ahead. Just be crisp and so that we get more questions and be very precise.
Sir, this is a question I want to ask Mr. Sudhir Gupta. In the morning, we had a session on different technologies, cellular technologies, 2G, 3G, 4G, catering to the data-hungry population of India. And in the post-lunch session, we are talking about broadband connection. So in terms of the high capital intensive industry, plus, getting return on investments, which is as low as 1%, what Mr. Gopal Vittal said, how does Tri play a role in, bridging the gap between all this?
Can you just repeat your last sentence?
Brief is that, you have one technology, cellular data on one hand, second technology is broadband on the other hand. We are talking about capital intensive, lot of investments, return on investments very less. Where does Tri play a role in terms of bridging this gap? Of providing solution, affordable solution to the data hungry population and the technology on the other end.
TRAI is a regulator for telecom and broadcasting. So, we are a technology neutral, technology agnostic regulator. So whether someone is providing 2G or 3G or 4G, it is their own business case. Yeah, we are gung-ho on broadband. We want broadband as a sort of a right for every citizen. But what will be the business case of each operator, whether they are while providing the service? It's their business case. We do not come into the ROIs or what kind of expenditures they are having. That's their case. So as a regulator, we are not supposed to be concerned with that.
I think we have run out of time, and I'm getting a lot of sign languages communication in the world of mobility to bring curtains down. Thank you very much for participating. Thank you very much to all the panel members, and thank you very much. Thanks a lot.